in prison for a murder he did not commit. The Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals ruled there was legally insufficient evidence to hold him, and he was released, but only for 4 short months. The U.S. Supreme Court reinstated his wrongful conviction, resulting in his returning to prison where he spent another 5 years before regaining his freedom via a no-low contendere plea, which I believe Professor Morris and I know my students and Mr. Johnson will explain to you what that is and some of the problems inherent in that situation. His choice was to go home the next day, take the plea, go home the next day, or risk continued imprisonment that might last 1 to 5 years, and maybe even lose. Lorenzo frequently speaks out about wrongful conviction as a columnist for the Huffington Post and other publications. He does media interviews, speaking engagements, and anti-wrongful conviction events. The Dustovic Foundation assisted Lorenzo in regaining his freedom, mainly in the public, relational, and grassroots level. We're still waiting on Marty Tankleff, but I will introduce, I'll give you his bio. Some of you who are a little bit older may remember this case because it happened right here on Long Island. A Long Island resident released from prison in 2007 after serving 17 years for a crime he didn't commit, the murder of his parents in 1988 when he was 17 years old. At the time of the Tankleff murders, Suffolk County law enforcement was under investigation for corruption, including problems with coerced confessions by the State Investigation Commission on the order of Governor Mario Cuomo, who's still our governor. The SIC's scathing report included a finding that the detective who would interrogate Marty had perjured himself in a previous murder case. Just weeks after his release, Marty resumed his college education at Hofstra University, where he received a BA in sociology. He then attended Toro Law School, earning a JD in 2014. While at Toro, Marty helped establish the Wrongful Conviction Externship Program that placed students in law firms working on wrongful conviction cases. We also have an internship program at Adelphi through the Criminal Justice Program, and you don't have to be a major to participate and get credit, a 3-credit course for participating in these sorts of internships. Since Marty's release, he's been a zealous and vocal advocate for those who've been wrongfully convicted. He testified before the New York State Senate, New York State Assembly, New York City Council, and various bar associations with the goal of making electronic recording of interviews and interrogations mandatory in New York. He is now actually an adjunct professor, in addition to his other accomplishments at Georgetown University and Toro Law Center. So before we begin today, I would like to give a big round of applause for all 3 of our speakers, and I will then invite Mr. Deskovic to come up and tell you a little bit about his story.
Good evening. Good
evening.
Pleasure to be in front of an audience, you know, especially one as large as this, and, you know, because I have in my mind the contrast when I was in Sing Sing prison, maximum security prison, where I was in my 16th year, you know, 15 to life sentence, and it was anything but clear that I was ever going to see the light of day again. So to go from that, when you really can't get anybody at all to hear you, to instead having a really nice, great audience like this, the contrast is pretty stark in my mind. So I was wrongfully in prison for I was arrested for a murder and rape which I did not commit. The year was 1990. It was here in New York, in Westchester County. Peekskill was a small population with approximately 25,000 people. Murders were very rare. So when this murder happened, it understandably created an atmosphere of fear, rumor, paranoia. Parents were concerned with their own safety as well as the safety of their children. In high school, I was quiet. I was telling myself I didn't participate in very many organized sports. This made me seem strange to kids in the high school. In the course of the police investigation, the police interviewed many students from the school. And some of them told the police that they might want to speak to me because I seemed strange to them. This is what the police said initially attracted them to me. The other factors they said attracted them to me was that they said that I was overly upset at the victim having been murdered. Yet there was mental health facilities set up all throughout the city of Peaceville to help people process what had happened. Again, keeping in mind that murders were very rare. So for about 6 weeks, the police played this cat and mouse game with me, in which half the time they would speak to me as if I was a suspect, and the other half the time they would pretend like they needed my help to solve the crime. They would say things like, the kids won't talk freely around us, but they will around you. Let us know if you hear anything. They made me the center of attention. They made me feel important. They used to ask me opinion questions and then congratulate me on my opinions being correct. My fantasy childhood career pre-teenage years was I wanted to be a cop, and so my age at the time was 16, along with this unexpected early opportunity to do this quasi-police work was how the police were able to pull the wool over my eyes. Another factor, psychologically, was that I came from a single-parent household. My father was never involved in my life in any aspect, and so that directly intersected with the police technique, Mutt and Jeff, good cop, bad cop, in which one officer takes on a more aggressive role, whereas his partner pretends to be a friend where, opposed to what's going on, yet somehow powerless to intervene as to the more aggressive cop. And of course, the purpose of that is so that when a person being questioned becomes frightened, it's only natural that you would look to a friendly face for assistance. Eventually, the police got me to agree to take a lie detector test, and so rather than report to the high school, I instead went to the police station, where I thought that the polygraph would happen because, so the rumor mill went, that a few other students had been polygraphed there. So because it was a school day, that meant neither my mother nor my grandmother realized that I was not in high school. They thought that nothing was wrong, and therefore they didn't call around looking for me. They drove me to the town of Brewster, which was in Putnam County, whereas I was a native of Peekskill in Westchester County. And the reason why that's important is that that meant that I was no longer able to leave on my own. I was instead dependent upon the police. Now, there were three officers who came there with me from Peekskill, but then there was also Putnam County Sheriff's Investigator Daniel Stevens, who was the polygraphist. And he was dressed as a civilian, and he was pretending not to be a cop. They gave me a four-page brochure on how the polygraph worked, and it had a lot of big words in it that I didn't understand, but I brushed aside my own concerns by just saying to myself, well, I'm here to help the police. Let's just get past this silly part of it when they talk to me like I'm a suspect, and let's get on with it. You know, let's just get to finding the actual person. So I'm here to help the police. What does it matter if I don't understand how the polygraph works? So from there, I was put in a small room, and the polygrapher gave me countless cups of coffee, which it seems fairly clear in hindsight that the purpose of giving me the coffee was to get me nervous. So from there, he attached me to a polygraph machine, and now I was kind of incapacitated. I couldn't move around. It was a rather large and heavy machine. And that's when he launched into his third-degree tactics. So he raised his voice at me. He invaded my personal space. He kept asking me the same questions over and over again. As each hour passed, so too did my fear increase in proportion to the time. Towards the end of the interrogation, the polygrapher made a statement. He said, "What do you mean you didn't do it? You just told me through the polygraph test result that you did. We just want you to verbally confirm it." So he said that to me, and that really shot my fear through the roof. And it was at that point that the officer who had been pretending to be my friend, he came in the room and told me that the other officers were going to harm me, that he had been holding them off, but could not do so any longer. You have to help yourself here. Do you understand? Well, considering that I had maintained my innocence for the previous 6.5 to 7 hours, it was clear what he meant by that. They wanted me to confess. When it was added that if I did as they wanted, that not only would they stop what they were doing, but that I could go home afterwards. Being young, naive, frightened, 16 years old, not thinking about the long-term implications, instead just being concerned with my own safety. Right then, right there, myself and the police, being in fear of my life, the fact that nobody knew where I was and that I didn't know where I was either loomed quite large. I was overwhelmed emotionally and psychologically. And then there was the push-pull dynamic, because on one hand, the possibility of harm had been mentioned, and on the other, he had thrown this false life preserver with this false promise. So I made up a story based upon the information which they had given me in the course of the interrogation, both that day and in the 6 weeks run up to it, as well as those items in the newspaper. By the time the interrogation was finished, I was on the floor, curled up into a fetal position, crying uncontrollably. Needless to say, I was arrested. I was charged with a murder and rape. So before I went to trial, the results of the DNA test came in from the FBI lab showing that seminal fluid found in the victim didn't match. But rather than acknowledge they made a mistake, they instead continued to prosecute full speed ahead. In order to counter the DNA evidence, the prosecutor got the medical examiner to commit fraud. So 6 months after doing this autopsy and without ever documenting anything, he suddenly remembered, hundreds of autopsies later, that he found medical evidence that he didn't document, which showed that the victim, who was a 15-year-old immigrant from Colombia, who'd been in the country for about a year and a half, leading a really sheltered life. She never went anywhere unless her older sister or parents were with her. He was willing to lie and say that he found medical evidence showing that she was sexually active. Basically, in order to wrongfully convict me, he was willing to falsely claim that she was sleeping around with any and everybody. That opened the door for the prosecutor to argue that it didn't matter that the semen didn't come from me. That didn't mean that I was innocent. That just came from somebody else that she slept with prior to being murdered and raped by me. Taking this slide a step further, he actually named another youth by name that he claimed had this encounter with the victim. But he never set a proper evidentiary foundation. He never had a DNA test performed on this other youth. He never called him as a witness to just give verbal testimony. He simply made the unsupported argument to the jury. At the same time, the public defender that I had was terrible. Basically, he didn't defend me. He never interviewed or called as a witness my alibi. I was actually playing wiffle ball when the crime happened. He never explained to the jury what the DNA test result meant. You know, he didn't use that to argue I was innocent. He didn't use that to argue that that proved that this so-called confession was coerced and false. It was time to discredit the medical examiner on cross-examination. He never answered, he never asked the medical examiner a single question. He very rarely met with me. Whenever he did meet with me, I tried to explain to him that I was innocent of what happened in the interrogation room. He was always shutting me up. One time he told me he didn't care if I was guilty or innocent. I wanted to testify at the pre-trial hearing. When there's a confession uses evidence, there's a pre-trial hearing called a hunting hearing, which is held in which the prosecution has to prove that the defendant was given their Miranda warnings and that the statements that they made was voluntary. So you have to have that hearing. The judge has to make that ruling before the trial can start, because that determines whether or not these statements could be used. So when the police interrogated me, they did not videotape the interrogation. They didn't audiotape the interrogation. There was no signed confession. It was just the cop's word for it. And so as a result of that, they were able to leave the threat and false promise out of their story. So I wanted to testify at that hearing to explain about the threat and false promise, but my lawyer wouldn't allow me to. He told me that he hadn't decided if I was going to testify at the trial or not, and therefore he didn't want to have me testify under oath as to what happened in the interrogation room, telling me that he put me on the stand during the trial that the prosecution could use the prior testimony to make it appear as if I was lying, even if I wasn't. But that didn't really make any sense, because first of all, if the judge had believed me, then the statements would have been ruled involuntary, and lacking any other evidence, it would not have been a trial. Secondly, if it really went that badly, I didn't have to take a stand at the trial, and if I didn't, there would be no way that the prior testimony could be used. But then when I got to the trial, he wouldn't allow me to testify there either. He told me that it wasn't his job to prove that I was innocent. It was up to the prosecution to prove that I was guilty, and he didn't think that it happened. Well, that's something you might hear in a classroom. It's a legal principle, but it doesn't work like that in reality. In reality, if you are charged with a crime you didn't commit, you have to do everything you can to prove that you're innocent, and you run a risk of possibly being wrongfully convicted. Add it all up, I guess it's not too surprising that the jury found me guilty. I'll never forget the day I was found guilty. It felt like I was in some sort of nightmarish return of reality, because to my way of thinking, at least up until that point in time, only guilty were convicted. Yet they said what they did, and I was taken into custody. On the day of the sentencing, I begged the judge to overturn the verdict because I was innocent, and I referenced the DNA to support my contention. He actually told me on the record, maybe you are innocent, conceding that there was a doubt. I mean, how could there not be a doubt? The DNA didn't match me. All they have is this so-called confession obtained under highly questionable circumstances. And the only way the two pieces of evidence fit is if you conclude that the confession is coerced and false. You might think, though, that having such a doubt would lead the judge to step up for justice and overturn the conviction, which he could have done by reversing any number of rulings he had made against me. Of course, that sentenced me to a term of imprisonment of 15 to life. So I'm going to share a few slides with you at this time. So this is what I looked like at the sentencing hearing. And this is a picture of me very early on in Elmira Correctional Facility, which is a men's maximum security prison. I want to share with you about how I was exonerated in the appellate process. And I'll make a return appearance at the back end of the program, and we'll talk about some of the forms and things to look ahead. So I naively thought that the court system got better and got more accurate the higher up that you went. So I went to the appellate division, the first court that one must go to, where my primary issues on appeal were my innocence, which was wrapped around three legal arguments that there was deeply insufficient evidence, that the prosecution hadn't proven guilt beyond reasonable doubt, and that the verdict was against the weight of the evidence. My lawyer argued that the statements against me were admitted in violation of my Fifth Amendment rights. And then there were six issues of law, which are kind of irrelevant to what we're talking about tonight. The appellate division ruled that I was not in custody at all, that I was free to come and go as I wanted, which was very important because that impacts the analysis of as to the interrogation. It lowers the burden. They ruled that my statements were voluntary, and they made short work of my innocence arguments. They wrote that there was overwhelming evidence of guilt, which is kind of a head scratcher as to how you get to overwhelming evidence of guilt on somebody who's factually innocent. And then they dispensed with my other six issues of law in one sentence. They said that they had looked at the remaining of my contention, and they had found it to either be without merit or not reserved for review. And as terrible as that decision is, that's the most that any court ever wrote about on any of my next six appeals, which I'm going to lay out for you. My lawyer moved to re-argue the case at the appellate division, arguing that the decision was running contrary to the facts of the law, but the re-argument motion was dispensed with one word, denied. We then went to the New York State Court of Appeals, New York State's highest court. The procedures, you have to ask for permission before you get them to agree to hear your case before they'll actually allow you to, you know, file a brief and get a decision on the case. So the Court of Appeals ruled that there was no merit in law to justify reviewing my case, so therefore they were declining to give me permission to appeal to them. I lost in federal court because the court clerk gave my lawyer the wrong filing information, which resulted in my petition arriving 4 days too late, which to then Westchester County District Attorney, at the time, Jeanine Pirro, her office took the position that those 4 days were prejudicial to the government, and therefore the court should simply rule that I was late without looking at my innocence argument and without looking at my Fifth Amendment argument. And that's the position that the court took. That meant I was time barred, which meant I was no longer able to argue my issues directly. I was limited to arguing that this procedural ruling against me was inaccurate. So I went to the Federal Court of Appeals, where I got permission from them to appeal to them on the procedural matter. The two judges hearing my challenges were Judge Rosemary Fuller and future U.S. Supreme Court Justice Sonia Sotomayor. My lawyer argued that this was not a delay caused by me and my attorneys, but instead by the misinformation of the court clerk. my lawyer argued that upholding a ruling like that would cause a miscarriage of justice to continue, which kind of backdoors the DNA and the innocence argument, at least as a contextual issue. The Federal Court of Appeals upheld the ruling. My lawyer then moved to re-argue the decision, requesting that all the judges on the circuit, all nine of them, make a decision. En banc is the legal term. But the re-argument motion was denied, and we sought permission from the U.S. Supreme Court to appeal to them. But they agreed to hear only between 2 to 5% of the total number of cases come in front of it. That is when this defendant appealing to them. Lorenzo will have something to say about that, as in his case you'll see injustice in terms of access to courts when he comes up next. But we realized that our chance of success there was slim, but I was out of the piece, so I had no choice but to forge ahead. But I was not able to overcome the odds. As expected, the United States Supreme Court declined to give me permission to appeal to them. That marked the end of my appeals and the end of legal representation. That was in 2001. So at that point, I had 11 years wrongfully imprisoned, and my appeals were exhausted. And because they were exhausted, the state figured I wasn't litigating anymore because I couldn't. So therefore, I no longer had a lawyer. So I started this letter writing campaign trying to find someone to take my case pro bono for free, and and also writing to get an investigator. Because when your appeals are over, the only way to get back into court is if you can find some previously unknown evidence of innocence. The only other way would be if there's some kind of retroactive change in the law. Other than that, you're out of court. So I wrote letters for 4 years. I wrote nonprofit organizations. I rarely heard back from them. I wrote large law firms. I rarely heard back from them. I wrote reporters who written about wrongful conviction cases. I was hoping that they would dig around, maybe write an article or two. My case would come to the attention of the necessary legal help, but I never heard back from them. I wrote nonprofit organizations that do free wrongful convicted prisoners, but the amount of people trying to get representation relative to the amount of people applying, I mean, there was a big disparity. And so my case was always passed over. Minimum, the correctional officials told me if I wanted any chance at all of making parole, which is already a slim possibility as it was, I would have to take and complete the sex offender training program, because the parole board wanted to see that the prisoners were, had taken a program addressing the crime for which they were in prison. The problem with completing that program, however, was that there was a guilt admission requirement tied to it. Everybody taking the program would be expected to admit guilt, not just to the instructor, but also to the other prisoners in the shop. A verbal rendition wouldn't cut it. They wanted it on paper, and they didn't want to hear that you were guilty. They wanted you to describe everything from beginning to end in all the gory details. Failure to complete any aspect of that would result in immediate removal from the program if the person being deemed to have refused to have completed the program. Kind of a similar philosophy to AA, where the first step is acknowledging you have a problem without which you cannot make any progress. So they're applying that inflexibly to that situation. In the end, I decided not to take the program. I think it's one of the best decisions I ever made. I went to the parole board, and I knew that they were in the habit of rubber stamp denying applications to anybody who had been convicted of a violent crime, even if they could demonstrate that they had been rehabilitated and that if they were released, that they would pose no threat to society. So I tried to protect myself. I raised the issue of my innocence. I referenced the DNA, but they were not willing to consider even the mere possibility. I answered a question that they had for me at the end of the interview regarding an aggression replacement training program that I taken the past. I gave him the answer. One of the commissioners said to me, "That's good, Mr. Deskovic, because you're going to need those skills to return back to society. Good luck." The procedure is that they don't inform you of their decision on the spot. It's sent via institutional mail, and the prisoner receives it 3 days later. While considering how the parole interview ended, I actually walked around the prison for the next 3 days thinking that I had somehow defied the odds and then I had to go home. When I got the decision in the mail and I read it, it noted that I had a great educational record, had a good disciplinary record, I had some letters of recommendation from the community, I even had a prison employee recommending that I be released, but that nonetheless, I had been convicted of a brutal and senseless crime, and to release me would be to lessen its seriousness, so they wrote. They ordered me to appear in front of them 2 days later, I mean 2 years later, excuse me. At that point, considering that I knew a lot of prisoners who were working on years 25 and 30, often a 15 to life sentence in which they would go to the parole board, be turned down, reappear 2 years later, get turned down again, and have that cycle continue in seemingly never-ending cycle of perpetuity, I felt pretty confident in prison that I was going to die in prison for a crime I didn't commit. In my 15th year, I wound up in contact with an investigator. I was writing a letter to a book author. Somebody at the company sent it to the investigator. She told me that since she lived and worked in both Colorado and Maine, that she couldn't work on my case, but that she would be willing to try to help me network through necessary legal services. One of her ideas proved to be the winning one. She suggested that I write the Innocence Project again, a nonprofit organization in Manhattan that pays off the convicted prisoners in those cases in which DNA testing can demonstrate innocence and in which no prior testing had been conducted. I wrote them back originally in 1992-93, but DNA was in its beginning stages. They had never before come across a case where there was a DNA exclusion and yet a conviction had resulted. The DNA data bank had not been created at that point. Their model was get testing of items and then reintroduce it in a post-conviction motion as newly discovered evidence, which was not an option in my case because the DNA already didn't match me and that was already in front of the jury. So if you want to think about it like that, you might actually say that I was excluded by the DNA a little too soon for my own good. So fast forwarding back into year 15, the investigator told me that in light of the DNA technology advancement that the prior denial was irrelevant. So I wrote them again. I would not have thought to write them again thinking I would get a similar response. So I didn't know it then, but I've learned since that once again, the Innocence Project didn't want to take my case because of the exclusion. So the intake worker there, who was not a lawyer, presented my case 3 times to them, finally pushing and getting it across, using an idea I'd suggested regarding the DNA data bank. So getting their representation was the first most significant thing. The second thing is Piro had left office and she was replaced by a different prosecutor who had her appeals dug in less. She was not dug in a Piro list. Plus the backstory was that the new DA didn't like the prior one, and the prior one was in the middle of her run for attorney general, and so I think she allowed them, their successor allowed me to have the testing without litigating over it, hoping that it would exclude me so that I could ruin her attorney general run. And plus, at that point in her career, Barry Sheff was a bigger public figure than what the Westchester DA was at that time, since she'd only been in office for about 16 months. So I was given the testing. So that was the second most important thing, is her leaving office. The third thing was that the actual perpetrator had committed a second murder 3.5 years later after killing the victim in my case, which resulted in his DNA being put into the data bank, so that when I did get the further testing through the data bank, his DNA was in the data bank and it matched him. So on September 20th, 2006, my conviction was overturned and I was released. I reported back to court November 2nd, 2006, at which point all the charges against me were dismissed on actual innocence grounds. I got acknowledgement of my innocence from the prosecutor and the judge, but neither of them were the counterparts who were originally involved into my case. So at that point, I was free to try to pick the pieces up the best that I could and try to rebuild my life. I'll show you another picture. I was released. So you can see the before, and you can see the after. So I'll wrap up by saying, I've become an advocate since being released. I was financially compensated after 5 years, and I used some of the money to start my nonprofit firstly, this is actually the day when we opened the organization. This is giving an idea of the frequency of wrongful convictions. So the gentleman with the red tie to my right, that's Fernando Bermudez, who did 18 years in prison on a wrongful conviction case in Manhattan. To my immediate left, with the bald head, the darker skinned gentleman, that's Jabbar Collins, who did 16 years on a wrongful conviction case in Brooklyn. To his left, you might recognize Raymond Santana from Central Park 5 fame. So in our 5.5 years, and I've gotten 7 wrongfully convicted people out, which is a high number. It's very hard to win these cases. So this is the first person we exonerated. This is William Lopez. He did 23.5 years in shotgun murder at a police guy in Brooklyn, rather. Really dramatic misidentification case. The witnesses said that it was two dark-skinned Panamanians, 6'1". You see, Mr. Lopez is 5'7", light-skinned Puerto Rican. And the weight estimation was 100 pounds heavier than what he was, so it's kind of obvious while he regarded him as innocent. We were able to come into his case in the last year. We did some investigative work in connection with his pre-existing legal team. So you might say put a section of the building in that was missing. So he did 23.5 years. He was exonerated, and he lived for a year and a half afterwards, and he passed away. This is our second exoneration here. To my left, that's William Hawley, who did 8 years and 4 months on an arson case that was actually an electrical fire. Here we didn't collaborate with anyone. We did this case totally in-house from soup to nuts. This is a picture of me when I graduated John Jay College with a master's degree. My thesis is written on wrongful conviction causes and the forms, which is important to know when I come back up again. I thought policy could understand that I'm not only talking from my personal experience, I'm providing formal education with that. Presented in front of a lot of police academies on ethics and best practices designed to prevent the wrong person from being arrested. I often tell them it's true that police can be the first line of defense in preventing a wrongful conviction. They don't arrest the wrong person, then the train never pulls out the station. And it's important to understand that the fight against wrongful convictions is against rogue cops and prosecutors who are violating the law and violating the correct procedures. It's not anti-law enforcement. They accept that premise before I wouldn't be allowed there. The last one is a picture of me here outside the Ace Law Library. I'm in my third year of law school. I'm halfway through the fall semester. I'm interested in my opinion exonerating some more people, but I want to do it as a lawyer. I'm not satisfied to sit in the front row of the court anymore. I want to be at the defense table and make a few of the arguments. So that's my aspirations, and I will hear later on again in the program and set things up. And my colleague and another foundation client, Lorenzo Johnson, who were friends and helped out on public relations front. It was a wild six-way collaboration featuring the attorneys Michael Wiseman, the Federal Capital Federal Habeas Unit, the Pennsylvania Innocence Project, Ronnie Sword from the Marty Tankleff case on the public relational, Thomas Victor from the Decarcerate, and a host of other people performing one function or another, but we all formed a team around Lorenzo, also who was helped to recruit others and still others. Lorenzo managed to bring to his defense from behind bars, and I really do believe that you need a team of people working on multiple levels. It's not all just a lawyer and investigator. It's a team approach to wrongfully convict. It's a team approach to exonerate everything. Everything counts. So with that, I'm going to wrap up for now. And this Professor Link will come up. And you want to just Lorenzo to come? All right, so I'm going to leave you. I'll be back a little bit later on. Thank you.
To introduce Mr. Johnson, Lorenzo Johnson.
I'm born and raised in New York, and in 1995, I was a speaker in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, and so my name got started on this
him from a grave case of ineffective assistance of counsel, prosecution of counsel, misconduct, and police corruption. That is my understanding. Now, when I say police corruption, I don't speak on all police. I speak on police who's responsible for injustice. So whenever you say prosecutor's misconduct or police misconduct, I'm focusing on them responsible for my case, his case, and many others. Okay. On December 15th, I arrived back in Hattiesburg, Pennsylvania, from Yonkers, New York, and I was locked up for fleeing and moving from police. And when I got to the police station, they said, you killed somebody last night. I was like, what are you talking about? They messing with me. I'm like, what are you talking about?
They had more evidence than what they turned out to actually have.
What was your perception of Moncrief, his defense lawyer, at the time of the trial?
It was, a seasoned, well thought out attorney.
He actually fell asleep during the trial.
A lot of attorneys listen with their eyes closed.
Mom, did you do that?
Volunteer Dixon walked out of Buffalo Courthouse at the 26th.
Avoid Madison. There's a lot of reading. He is up.
Alright. After 27 years in prison, Kenneth Vaughn currently is represented by Mid-Atlantic Mrs. Roger Cooley. Tim Wright is currently represented by Emily Munn from Pinkin Dump. John Moss is being interviewed by Houston. So when you think undergraduate students can make a difference, he just proved everyone wrong. It's what I do, it's part of what Jeff does, it's part of what Lorenzo does. Because who better to advocate for the innocent than each one of us? Each one of us has our own perspectives. Each one of us has our own ways of making a difference in people's lives. Quite often I hear, what can I do? How can I get involved? Very easy. You can go to the Innocence Project, you can look on their website. You can start an Innocence Project at your school. I'm sure Cory would be more than honored to help set something up that high. Because you think about what you're doing when you give somebody back their freedom. You're almost giving them a new lease on life. It's almost their rebirth. Because I lost 18 years, Jeff was 16, Lorenzo. You think about that, right? It's over 50 years. Okay, Valentina Dixon was 27 years in prison. Who is over 27 in this room? So everyone who's under 27, imagine losing your entire life. What that's like. You can go to makingexonerated.com because if you want to look about more about the cases, each one of the students' groups created short documentaries, and they're only about 8 to 9 minutes long. And I think it really does inspire people to understand how you can make a difference. In the Kenneth Bond case, you saw Ramon Williams, who was the original eyewitness. There were three young girls, Julia, Cassidy, and Nadia, who originally they thought Ramon was the real shooter. They were so fearless that they start knocking on doors by themselves, going to some of the worst neighborhoods of Baltimore. But they turned around and said, we can't be afraid because Kenneth Vaughn is in prison. And if you think about that, how many of you in this room would be comfortable going to a maximum security prison or go